We good? Okay. Morning, everybody. Graham Peacock from TD Bank. So I won't bore you with the introduction again. I think you saw that at the keynote. You know, the background of the bank and the explosive growth over the last couple of years is compelling. And I think, you know, from Monday, we understand the challenges that that imposes upon any infrastructure team or any technology team. So what we're going to do today is really walk you through some of the thought process and some of the detail behind, you know, what we've achieved and how we did it. So, you know, this page is familiar. You know, Vasil wanted to call this moonshot, which I think is appropriate. I do need to thank Spellcheck for this. It could have been a much worse slide. But really what we're doing is looking to impose a generational shift on the way that the bank builds, deploys, and supports technology. And that's a huge undertaking. So, you know, when you're building a rocket, the first thing you need is a monkey to test it on. So looking at the evolution of where we are, and, you know, across the bottom of the page, I want to just list some of the, you know, the features or capabilities that you would expect, you know, as you evolve through that journey. And I think, you know, you start in a very, very manual way. At the far left-hand side, your designs are entirely custom, bespoke. And as you get towards the right-hand side, you expect a degree of standardization, commoditization, and automation. And, you know, it would be nice to go through a number of well-defined steps to get from the far left-hand side to the right-hand side. We didn't do that. We were somewhere, you know, within that red box. We didn't really distinguish between how we built, you know, physical machines or virtual machines. In fact, the process was identical. The release process for applications was identical and highly manual. And effectively, you know, what we chose to do is jump to the far right. So not necessarily the way you would want to embark on this journey, but nevertheless the way that we had to move forward. So the first thing that occurs to you is OMG. You know, you start thinking about the solution that you think you need and the number of players in the market and the feeding frenzy that is happening across, you know, most vendors, you know, particularly whenever they mention the word cloud. It generates a huge amount of confusion, and it's a pretty daunting task. You know, yes, we understand the problem that we have, you know, today. We realize that we need to move forward, but, you know, maybe a better title for this would have been WTF. So, in terms of direction, what do we think were, you know, the important criteria, you know, as we embarked on this decision? So, you know, clearly we expect to be heading towards public cloud. We just don't know when yet. I think the banking industry, you know, the regulators need to become comfortable with that. We need to understand the risks that we're taking on. We need to plan for that journey. We need to get there in baby steps as far as is possible. We also know that we've got applications that we've accumulated over many years. You know, those applications are pretty chatty, that they're pretty latency sensitive. Jumping to public cloud would be disastrous for many reasons. So how do we get there? We also have a lot of congestion in our data centers, and, you know, shifting data center, you know, topology is actually very, very difficult. And, you know, clearly we wanted to head towards public cloud by building a private cloud initially. But if you build that off-premises and force our development teams to work off-premises within the private cloud, then I think it eases the journey towards public. So that was one of the decisions we made fairly early on. We also wanted a fully managed infrastructure service. Yeah, we see building, you know, hardware as really a commodity. There's other companies out there that can do that far better than we can, that can support them far better than we can. And that part of the cloud offering is very mature, I think, at this point. Platform as a service, far less so. So we chose to focus, you know, our internal resources on the platform as a service, you know, problem and work through that solution. And, you know, that was a pretty daunting task, but clearly we wanted to partner with somebody to manage both the off-premises and on-premises piece of private cloud and infrastructure as a service for us. You know, looking further out, you know, we expected Docker to play a major part in our future. Clearly we need to get from, you know, the cloud offering that we intended to stand up on day one through to containerization and manage the impact on the development teams across the organization. And bear in mind what I said on Monday, right? There's 10,000 people in the technology team at TD. Now, you know, beyond provisioning platform as a service, clearly we expect to move up the food chain. There's an awful lot of things that applications are doing repeatedly across the enterprise that effectively could be and should be better done by the infrastructure team. So, you know, beyond containerization, clearly we expect to be in a position to provide APIs that provide API, you know, infrastructure services to those development teams and help, you know, consolidate and centralize some of that functionality. So that's the direction that we laid out, you know, for ourselves. Nothing, you know, too earth-shattering there, but, you know, we were very, very new to this. Second question is, you know, who do I trust? And one of the problems that we see in the industry is, you know, we like open source, but there's so many applications, so many components. And it feels like, you know, every time that somebody in the community runs into a problem, their solution is always to, you know, throw away that particular component and build a new one. So it's a very, very confusing space to work in. And I think it's also way too big for any one person or any one company to try to or be able to solve all of the problems that we're going to encounter. So partnership is crucial. So we started looking for people that can actually add value and help us navigate through this problem. So we were looking for a certain type of behavior, right? Certain criteria from the people that we wanted to partner with. Communication is crucial, right? As I said, it's a very, very complex space. A lot of different maturing technologies. Integration, you know, kind of works sometimes. And I think we had to navigate this in a very, very short amount of time. So moving at pace is absolutely key. You know, we made the decision to move forward with a cloud at TD in about July last year. We were then given until December to stand it up for the first time. So a typical banking fashion, you're given a date and then work backwards from that date to make it work. Right? Very, very difficult. Now, you know, clearly we like people that are focused and deeply technical. And it might sound obvious, very, very hard to find a lot of these people within the industry. Simplicity, I think, is key, given the complexity that I've talked about and the immaturity that I've talked about. You know, being able to communicate the solution simply across a very, very broad organization, absolutely crucial. I think experience is everything, right? So the number of people that we have that are capable of working through very, very complex problems and coming up with very simple solutions and being able to communicate them again and again and again across an organization of 10,000 people, very, very hard. So even having, you know, even finding people that have solved some of these problems before, absolutely essential to running this kind of project in the amount of time that we had. I think, you know, partnership is bi-directional. You know, everybody talks about it during their sales process. You know, generally, when you sign, you know, your signature on the contract, partnership evaporates pretty quickly. So we were pretty interested in finding people that, you know, truly believed in partnership the way that we did and actually really wanted to partner around product strategy. You know, we're a bank. We're figuring this out as we go. Clearly, there'll be things that we need to be built into multiple products for us if they make sense. Yeah, to actually allow us to contribute to the strategy across the community. I think openness, very, very important. There's an awful lot of proprietary solutions out there. You know, historically, we've been a buy rather than a build bank, but we were very concerned about being locked in to any particular solution that we chose. And I think that was one of the most compelling reasons about the open source community, right? There's a lot of plug and play. If one particular component doesn't work out, we can switch it out. So those were the qualities that we were looking for. Moving forward, you know, we selected 7 vendors to provide the cloud solution with us. These are the most important. And starting from the bottom, you know, I think it's crucial that you identify like-minded individuals, you know, smart, deeply technical, very, very motivated. You know, a company like RiskFocus, you know, allowed us to shorten probably what would have been a 2-year time frame into something that, yeah, sure, we stood up a development cloud in a few months. By the time we have the production cloud stood up in July this year, it'd be a year. But I would say that, you know, by choosing the right people and focusing on people that are narrower but deeply technical, that allowed us probably to shorten what would be a two-year project and deliver in one. The middle section, think of Rackspace, need a little introduction. Clearly, once you decide you don't want to go down a proprietary route for cloud, you want to stay with an open source solution, then you're probably going to partner with the folks that created OpenStack. The logo I actually like, there's a lot of Rackspace logos out there. I think die trying, I think, you know, tells an awful lot about, you know, what we had to achieve and the partnerships that we built and the approach that they took. So there's a lot of people here, and I think the philosophy is very much, you know, let's do it once, let's get it right, but we are going to die trying. Cloudify at the top, you know, there's a lot of orchestration software out there. We were pretty long on Tosca. I think we like the abilities that it gives us to build, you know, standard reusable design components in a relatively straightforward language, and to actually educate the development community to, you know, take the platform blueprints that we build and actually extend them and take them into the, you know, the infrastructure of software or the application space. And, you know, I think without Tosca and without specifically the Cloudify implementation of Tosca, we couldn't have done that. So that's a lot of the stack. The other pieces are a little bit more obvious. You know, clearly we use Salt, we use Rundeck, you know, and the others. But I think these are the three key partnerships and the like-minded set of individuals that, you know, we identified and we brought together. And as I said, you know, in the period between July and December, we stood up an off-premises cloud, including full connectivity, in a very, very short amount of time. Okay, gonna hand over now to Vasil Avramov. He actually works at Risk Focus. He's gonna walk you through some of the technical decisions that we made and the architecture that we actually ended up with, and then I'll come back.
Hey guys, so I'm speaking on behalf of the TD implementation team, but really there's no way that I can claim the credit for this implementation. I think a lot of the TD employees that were actually there when we started and joined afterwards were actually much more instrumental to standing this thing up than I have or Risk Focus has been. Some of them are in the audience, so if you ask me some hard questions at the end, I'll just direct them to him. So, of course, when you start off with an architecture, you need to first pontificate on what principles you want to espouse. And for us, of course, one of the really key ones was componentized architectures. And we knew upfront that monolithic architectures will just not serve our purposes. We need to be able to not just put new apps onto the cloud, but we need to be able to migrate apps which were never intended to do that. The whole tool chain is evolving at such a pace that there is nobody who has the whole solution, and nobody will have exactly the solution that TD needs. So we need to break it up into pieces and then actually control the solution, even if we use off-the-shelf components or buy components. The reason we go for open source is not because it's free, but because it's open. Right, it makes things debuggable, searchable, and very, very importantly, there's a community around it, which in essence acts like a force multiplier for your support. We did look at some of the full-scale solution vendors, and we just found that it was very hard to get an answer out that was technical enough and to the point. Usually, you just takes a long time. So. And we, of course, needed to go with standards. So Tosca is one of the few standards out there right now for orchestration. And that not only allows us to avoid vendor lock-in, but in terms of both the different IaaS, as well as to move potentially from other orchestration tools if we find at some point that there are ones that serve our purposes better. Now, we've even actually exploited this capability right now because we were trying to stand up an Oracle Rack instance into OpenStack and we were unable to do it, but the blueprint was portable and so we were just going to move it to VMware. Like, our clients don't really care. Of course, the problem is that there's, you know, lots and lots of integration points, and I'll show you what our architecture diagram looks like. So The key thing to take away is that the control plane on the left drives the different IaaS implementations, both on-premise and off-premise. There are also, as you can see, a very large number of components and moving parts. However, the top, the top left-hand corner, I don't know if you can see my mouse over there, is most of these components are actually all just Cloudify Manager. So even though there's a lot of these different processes, they all run within the same Docker container and represent one component. I think what you're seeing is that as you move into a kind of a tool chain, a lot of the tools themselves are componentized, and you almost get this fractal view of components repeating themselves. Now, you know, there are concerns. So firstly, things change at a crazy pace, and there's so much churn. Backwards compatibility and kind of consistency take a backseat. We chose 7 products, and we ended up with 45 transitively. So our efforts to try and limit the catalog of technologies that we will support as a bank, we sort of ourselves tripped over ourselves. The other thing is you really need like a high level of skills. So you need the commitment that on the one hand, the organization is going to be willing to go out and hire very, very capable technologists. And equally importantly, the commitment to train their existing resources on the new system. The existing tooling and skill sets are just not sufficient. However, there is a lot of transparency. So we see the bugs and via Jira and whatever other bug trackers are publicly available. You can see them being resolved. You can also see very large numbers of them, right? In the current OpenStack distribution that we're running on has something like 10,000 bugs. So that's kind of a large number, but then when you think about it, who knows how many bugs are there in the closed source vendors, right? So I think just because you don't want to see how sausages are made doesn't make them any safer. The other thing is, you know, there is a lot of enthusiasm in the community. I mean, I think the fact that we're all here today speaks volumes. Of course, self-serve was one of the main things we wanted to address. Because we chose a componentized architecture of kind of single purpose tools, by definition, there was nothing that would just fully glue it and provide a unified user experience. So we had to build our own microservices and UI, and also introduce concepts that were just missing. For example, we introduced the notion of a service catalog. That service catalog is actually maintained by the various business aligned teams, so they can have control over it. Developers can go in, select blueprints, customize the flavor that they want to deploy, and just click and deploy. Now, when a VM is finally deployed, it is actually fully bank compliant. It has all the agents installed onto it. It's up to date, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, another thing that was missing is kind of any level of monitoring and control. I think if you enter into, I think generally OpenStack is pretty mature from an operational perspective, and I think if you're going in expecting a very luxurious ride, you're not going to be in for a treat. However, because it's so open, you can actually build tooling around it pretty quickly, and you can see just some of the dashboards that we've put together provide a lot of transparency. Also, because our stack is way more than just OpenStack, the tooling needs to be cross-cutting. And again, that's not something, even if OpenStack did have extremely rich capabilities, because that's not the full solution, we will still need to build on top of it. And of course, there needs to be cost transparency, right? So not only are we changing the model of pricing, but also if we have this self-serve module, but at the same time, figuring out how much you need to invoice your customers is a manual exercise, we've not really solved the problem, right? So costing and transparency and self-service has to be part of that whole equation too. So What approach do we take on in order to execute? Well, it was just try and cut scope and run like hell. So I think we just had to embrace the fact that we don't know what we don't know, and we're just gonna have to try. And we were able to make significant progress. It had its challenges, and we'll have this slide. But then once we actually stood up the first version of the cloud, we had to stop and reorganize, because you can't go from a tiny little team that's running at high speed to a large team that can service an enterprise without any structure and without any pause. So we ended up restructuring the team, and we broke it into three pieces. So there's the core development piece, which essentially is responsible for maintaining the cloud service layer. There's another team which is responsible for kind of acting essentially like professional services internally and helping the business aligned teams to migrate their applications onto the cloud. They also act like a business requirements and testing team for us to a large degree. And then there's a team which is responsible for just putting new services on that platform. So we started off with only Red Hat, WebLogic, WebSphere, and JBoss, and by now there's Windows and IIS and SQL Server and Oracle and so on and so on. So that's a separate team which doesn't necessarily need to know everything about the cloud service layer. They just need to know about how to move different platforms onto the cloud, and in some ways the expertise within those platforms is more important than a full understanding of the cloud. And we had challenges. So literally, probably the biggest change is that we're constantly behind. I mean, we're always catching up. And since we're onboarding clients while at the same time we're trying to build out the platform, you know, things break. And that just requires a lot of support from management. Thank you, Graham. And from all the clients, you need some understanding that we are trying to compress the time frames, which means that it'll be more of a rocky ride to get there. And of course, we've had outages. Just any outage, we've had it. So we brought down RabbitMQ and brought down the whole of OpenStack. We had bugs in every single bit of software stack, and it's a pretty deep software stack, so we've been just encountering a lot of that. And there's just a very complex connectivity. Extending a network to add a few floating IPs shouldn't turn out to be a week-long debacle, but you know, you learn and we incorporate it. So back to the kind of processes. So you know that the Acela train, which is clearly a way faster train than the one on top, runs between Boston and DC. So the old train's average speed was 63 miles per hour. The Acela's one is 65 miles an hour. So just changing, putting in a shiny new toy without changing the processes will not give you the solution that we're after. So there are examples of this that we encounter on an everyday basis. So the security ID solution that we were using required for people to go in once a machine comes online to go into a portal and enter the IP. That just does not work very well when you have a cloud. Thankfully, in this specific case, it turned out that there were APIs and we could automate it. But that was just one example for one agent. So re-architecting the processes is one of the really key, hardest things to do. And Graham, I think with this, I can hand it over.
Okay, so moving forward. Or not. There we go. You know, we've accumulated processes in the same way as we've acquired businesses. And, you know, working across, as I said earlier, 10,000 different technology individuals, and probably something in excess of 20 different business lines, the processes tend to sprawl, and there's many exceptions. The top left-hand corner is a real page from actually one of our infrastructure design processes. That's page 1 of 5. You know, so historically, the process to design, specify, you know, move money around, ultimately purchase, build a servers, actually, you know, can take something between 30 to 90 days. Now, we would have loved to just drop a new process on top of our shiny new cloud, but then we'd end up with two, right? Because most of the applications moving to cloud actually need to span both the old and new environment. You know, until we get all of our data sources to cloud, there's an awful lot of cross-connectivity. And that means you're forcing many projects, if not all projects initially, to follow both the old process and the new process. Now, clearly, they're both moving at very, very different speeds. And inevitably, what happens is that the new cloud process ends up waiting for the old one, and not just hours or days, but weeks. So we had no choice but to take a step back and say, look, we're going to have to define a single new process, and it's going to have, sure, the occasional branch that caters for dependencies on the, you know, the old world, but we're going to have to define, educate, and move the entire organization to that new process. So, you know, very, very difficult task when you think about where we are and the fact that the existing process involves many people across many, many teams. And the way that teams typically build process is they provide gates, or maybe better description is a wall, directly in front of them, right? So they protect themselves from everybody upstream. And breaking down those walls and integrating those teams, you know, creating new process and then looking at automating that process, I think is probably the most difficult task of the entire project. You know, yes, you know, getting 50 or so open source components to work together, very, very difficult. Changing the process that 10,000 people have been living with for the best part of 10 years, very hard. The two things are in our favor, right? So the bottom left-hand corner, clearly we have a reasonably well-defined PMLC or SDLC process. We're pretty waterfall in the bank. It's very hard to be agile given the process I've just defined. So waterfall helped us. And, you know, whilst some of those gates, some of those walls that I've mentioned, you know, weren't terribly value add and certainly weren't going to appear in the future state, there's a couple of gates that actually helped us. So, you know, firstly, anybody who needs a server in the bank has to come and talk to me. So, you know, clearly implementing a cloud first strategy becomes very easy. You have to convince me to buy a server. Otherwise, you're going to cloud. So I'm granting very, very few exceptions, right? So if anybody wants to run a project, I'm forcing them all to cloud. And there needs to be a very, very good reason why they can't do that. Yeah, and I've got air cover right up to the chief executive to do that. Very important. I think the second thing is, you know, you need to also consider the implications of a self-serve model. You know, developers want to play with a lot of shiny new toys. Now, if you remember back to Monday, one of the problems we're solving is the diversity we have in the data center. So yeah, we selected 7 technologies to build cloud on. They brought 40-something friends in the open source community. So we introduced 50 technologies, let's say. But we had a catalog of over 1,000 platforms. Yeah, we've only decided to move 7 of those to cloud. And Vasil mentioned them, right? It literally is SQL Server, Oracle, WebSphere, JBoss, Windows, IIS, and Linux. That's it. If you want self-serve, if you want the instantaneous gratification that you desire, use one of those 7. If you want to go off-piste and use something from the 1,000-line catalog you're used to, fine. I'm going to make it very, very hard for you to build it. If you want to build it, I'm going to make it very, very hard for you to do it quickly. It's going to be manual. It's going to be very, very slow. And I'm not going to automate it. Your choice. So I think those two things helped us. But I think also it's important to know that there has to be a second gate, right? So I've talked about gating the cloud-first model. The second gate has to be around quality. So if you've got people playing in a self-serve sandbox, and they are consuming a lot of resources in that sandbox, and they don't really want constraints, you have to have a gate, you know, ahead of them promoting software into the upper environments and clearly ahead of them getting anywhere close to production. And that gate really does two things, right? It allows us to take a look at what they've done, to identify things that they should have done better or differently, and actually work with them to introduce, you know, things that we missed, right? So that the next person doesn't have to jump through quite so many hoops. And I think, you know, that's the process that we're working towards. Clearly, as we extend across other functions, it gets much more complicated. But I think, you know, the most important slide in the deck, the process re-engineering aspects of introducing a cloud on an enterprise of this size are huge. Moving forward, we talked a little bit about adoption governance on Monday. Now, the top left-hand corner is really an adoption or maturity curve. well, S-curve, as the industry calls them. And clearly, we're trying to jump from one S-curve to another that's dramatically different. But, you know, as you begin, bottom left-hand corner of that curve, you're innovating, right? You're prototyping. You have no users, right? You can move very, very quickly. As the product matures, you slow down a little bit. You start acquiring users. You discover problems you never had envisaged. And I think the way that you want to drive adoption, the way you want to govern adoption, changes. Clearly, the product becomes mature at some point, right? You start ramping up that incline. The product gets mature. It becomes more standard, becomes more of a service. And teams like mine, right, the engineering team, can disengage a little bit. Not that we're going to stop investing in the platform, right? It's crucial that we continue to do that. But the way that we're gating people that want to run projects and the way that I'm forcing them to cloud because, hey, there's no choice, you're using it, that changes. That's reactive. So clearly, as you start going up that incline and you start plateauing, you need to be very much more proactive. You know, so the people that I'm forcing to cloud, people that are adopting cloud right now, are people that are running projects. And you essentially do that because it's part of your business strategy for this year or because you have a major currency issue this year that you have to adopt. There's a huge part of the application portfolio that the businesses aren't touching this year. They don't need to change those applications. Therefore, in the reactive way that we're approaching the problem right now, those applications would never migrate to cloud. So really at the bottom, you know, clearly I've said that we have a lot of support from the chief executive down. The CIOs across the business lines are all in on this solution. And they're all committed to moving 80% of their application portfolio to cloud within 5 years. You don't necessarily want to trust them all to do that. Right? So really you need a different type of governance. You need to spin up a program team independently from the platform team, whose job it is to proactively work across, as I said, 20-something business lines to actually understand their application portfolio, to understand their application architecture, to break down those architectural dependencies and actually work out what the graph looks like to migrate those components one at a time to cloud and put plans in place quarter by quarter, year on year for the next 5 years, yeah, in order for those business lines to commit to that, to understand how they do that, in order that the center of the house can track their progress. Not that we want to name them and shame them, but we can't wait 5 years and find out, oh, we didn't do it, we forgot, right? We have to track their progress on a frequent basis, and that's where dashboarding comes in. That's where having a different type of proactive program management, you know, really becomes very, very important. So that's really the governance piece. Now, there's some psychology here that we should probably talk about. So we talked about the maturity curve, the adoption curve, you know, a little bit like this, right? So, you know, clearly there's always innovators, there's early adopters. The vast majority clearly jump on board the bandwagon, you know, towards the right-hand side of the curve. There's an emotional roller coaster that comes with this. So the curve at the bottom really represents that. So the peak at the left-hand side of the bottom curve really is, you know, there's an awful lot of enthusiasm, an awful lot of selling that happens early on in this kind of initiative. And it's very easy to mismanage the expectations across the entire enterprise. Right? So everybody gets very, very excited. As soon as that's over, you have another WTF moment, right? It's like, I'm not doing this. I don't want to do this. Why are they making me do this? If I keep quiet, they'll go away, right? So there's a lot of very, very negative reaction that happens, you know, where it says disillusionment there. Someone's forcing me to do something. I just want to be left alone, do my job. Why are they making me do it? So the industry typically calls this the valley of death. Right? It takes a very long time to work through this to the point where you can realize those expectations. Right? You need to retool the entire enterprise. You need to start working up the other side of that curve. You need to have people see the value of what you're making them do. And it's not until you get to that point where they're beginning to, you know, realize some of that initial promise and they get past a number of, you know, of their initial fears or expectations that you actually start to realize the value. And that means that you actually started to mature the product quite well. As I said, you've got an independent program to run the adoption process. People are not so much questioning it. They're actually providing feedback into product strategy. So you just get through that valley. And it's crucial that you keep, you know, your early adopters very, very engaged. Right? If you lose your early adopters through that process, you're screwed. Right? So I think the psychology of what we're trying to do is very important. And it's very easy to underestimate the impact, you know, of that emotional roller coaster. Okay. Now, the last bullet point, clearly, you know, if we put a couple of bullets on there for, you know, private cloud versus public cloud, I'm guessing it's at least a 5-year journey. Clearly, by introducing private cloud, we're moving the entire organization in one direction. As I said earlier, we're addressing some of our application design issues, some of our latency sensitivity. But I think it won't be until we reach that enlightenment phase that people truly, you know, within the bank and across the industry will be ready to move from private to public. And, you know, maybe 5 years, 10 years down the road, why would we have a data center? Moving forward. So, you know, as I said, we talked about moonshot. We talked about testing our rocket on monkeys. I think preparing for space is, you know, following on from that emotional roller coaster, right, the psychology slide. Clearly, we started off at the far left-hand side with some terrified individuals across the entire organization. We spent a while, you know, finding them, wrangling them, forcing them to attend meetings, you know, forcing them to be trained. Clearly, we created an environment where it was relatively safe to play. You know, so in the center picture, clearly you got, you know, my first VM. You know, we educated people continuously. You know, we trained 1,500 people, as I said, you know, through the first 3-4 months of this year. And that wasn't just one training course, that's multiple training courses. We run bi-weekly open mic sessions. We push out bi-weekly FAQs. It's a constant effort to train the organization of this size. And as that snowball runs downhill, it gets harder and harder. And people forget, right? This is a learning curve, but there's also a forgetting curve. And it's a constant battle to keep the entire organization engaged, to make sure we don't lose those early adopters, to make sure that we generate and keep the excitement that we need to keep this project on track. And remember, it's a 5-year project, right? As I said, we stood up cloud in 4 or 5 months last year. We'll have the entire production thing up in July this year. That's within a year, you know, of the board agreeing the investment. That's a huge achievement. But, you know, the engineering job is 80% complete at that point, right? So we need to take the platform forward, it needs to mature. But the job of adoption continues for much, much longer. You know, so I'll have moved on, I'll be solving other problems. But the people managing the adoption will be there for a very long time. Okay, I think we're almost done. So in terms of next steps, we're working through a little bit of design, you know, for regulatory reasons. So putting credit card information in a virtual environment is a little bit complex. We're extending the cloud into our DMZ, which makes it a little bit less elastic, to be honest. Clearly, you've got a vision of a single cloud. When you end up zoning it across development, SITS, BAT, PAT, production, and disaster recovery environments, and across web application and data tiers, then we're going to end up with 12 zones in our cloud, right? Or with physically dedicated servers. So, you know, it isn't a single cloud, it's 12 clouds at that point. A little bit more complexity than we originally imagined. Application onboarding, I've spoken to, scale is something that, you know, clearly we need to deal with, and you know, having hundreds of applications on the cloud, very, very different from having the entire application portfolio of 4,000 on cloud. So scale is something we're going to be working through for a while. Docker, I've mentioned, and we're hiring. So, you know, we have a vacancy. You guys are here. And I've got bananas. All right, so that's the end of the presentation. So anybody's got any questions, I'm sure Vasil, Quinn, or I are happy to answer any of them.
You mentioned, hello, I was wondering what were some of the critical mistakes that you made along the way, and then what did you learn from those mistakes? Because nobody gets it right the first time.
I think, you know, going back to the curve that we saw earlier, right? The initial selling, you know, I've avoided sales all my life. It's very easy to get an entire organization excited, motivated, and to raise expectations through the roof. And, you know, I fought against others in the bank that you know, went a little bit too far in that direction. I lost. But clearly I then get the challenge of working through that early miscommunication or that you know, that sales process. And correcting. So, you know, I would always fight against that, right? I think it's better to start quietly, you know, to develop a solution to allow it to mature a little bit, then start selling it. That's just me. I totally get the way that banks work. But I would call that a miss. Think in terms of technologies, you know, sure, you know, we're trying to dramatically reduce our catalog. We went, you know, very carefully through the selection process for how we wanted to build, you know, the pass layer. And as I said, we selected seven technologies. You know, I'm trying to gate the new technology introduction process. Seven technologies, that's okay. As I said, we introduced 50 to make it work, right? That was unintentional, right? So we've been backdooring technologies and avoiding the process that I run on behalf of the enterprise in order to get this project done. I think the second thing is, you know, clearly by nature, I don't like planning on a right to left basis. When my boss gives me a date and tells me to get it done, it's not a great feeling. You know, I'd always prefer to plan on a left to right basis, optimize the hell out of it. But at that point, the date is the date, yeah? So I think, not mistakes, but in terms of things I would do differently, I think those are they, right? Clearly, you know, if I were allowed to run this in a slightly different way, there might have been a different result. But almost certainly, it would have taken a lot longer. Anything else?
So the scope here is you're a bank and you're a big player and you've taken a very comprehensive stance. Can you share what precipitated the spark that started this journey? Because looks like you're going full out with the moonshot.
I think it was an appreciation for, you know, how dramatically we'd grown as I started with, but how our project-centric focus really had driven that explosive growth, but it almost prohibited, you know, any kind of automation and any kind of standardization. When you're making decisions so transactionally, and that's introduction of new technologies, that's, you know, typically throwing people at testing or release management, then I think, you know, clearly that's a great way to build a business, right, transactionally, in a siloed kind of approach. We've got 20 businesses, they're all entirely independent. But to a certain extent, some of them are building the same kind of software, the same kind of solution, solving the same kind of problem, right? So it gets expensive, and it gets fragmented, it becomes fragile, it gets harder and difficult and costly to maintain. So I think it was an appreciation for, you know, the way that we developed software, the way that we've grown, as I said, waterfall style over the past 10 or so years, can't be the way that we move forward, right? Everybody talks about agility, but achieving agility in the environment that we had was never really an option.
But where was the aha moment that you actually said, okay, we got the problem, everybody understands the problem, or I've set the table, now the solution is cloud. Give me whatever it takes to go there.
It was actually a complaint that happened a couple of months ago. You know, whenever we had the process whereby it took 30 to 90 days to actually get a server in the bank, built and configured, people kind of accepted that. There weren't a lot of complaints on a day-to-day basis around that. And then a couple of months ago, we started attracting complaints. You know, from developers, you know, why is my VM taking 15 minutes to start? You know, didn't anticipate that. You know, that's a hard problem to solve. But that was kind of the moment that we realized that we've turned a corner, right? And we're engaging the community in a different way.
Sorry, I just wanted to back up to the actual one. That's the cloud now, but you're saying the way we're doing it now ain't gonna get us there. Somebody's had to
Correct.
Say, I gotta do it differently, here's my plan. That's like, I'm trying to find out where that spark that kicked off that journey happened.
So the journey happened in the way I described, right? It was really a time to market play. Now, as we were building the business case I mentioned, you know, clearly the bean count has turned that into a cost play. And we struggled with that for several months. You know, how on earth do you demonstrate you're going to save money through building a cloud? It's not cheap to build. You know, the change the bank aspect of it, running a project, the work might move around a little bit, but most of it is still there. You know, when people are waiting, as I said, 3 months for a server, they're doing other stuff, right? They're not spending money waiting. As you get into the operational part of it, you know, the run the bank part of cloud, then you can see some savings there. You know, our utilization on physical hardware was horrible. It was 25%, right? Even on virtuals we were building, it was more like 50. If we can realize something like 75% of resource utilization on cloud, then that's a savings, right? We can model that. But it's about working through that process, you know? And it's about understanding how you automate it, what you automate first, how to realize those savings. So as we went through this journey, the cost dimension became much, much more important than the time dimension. And that was a surprise.
Well, you kind of touched on my question already, but it's clear that from the top down that your organization gets cloud. And I'm wondering if you've had a chance to turn your thoughts to bottom-up kind of stuff, encouraging the users to be good cloud citizens with, say, a billing system or whatever, you know, so that they turn their instances off when they're not in use, and you can really start gaming the system like you do with Amazon.
That's a great question. So I think Vasil touched on billing, but you know, moving to a self-serve model, we predicted 10,000 VMs over 5 years, right? So we stood up 2,000 in December, or at least capacity for 2,000. By April, we'd pretty much run out of space, and that was developers playing in the environment. And some of that was legitimate project execution, some of it was trial and error. As I said, we created a safe place for them to experiment, and a lot of them were running performance tests. Yeah. But very few people were behaving in a responsible way. Now, historically, when you're buying a server, you pay for it for the full depreciation cycle, right? The server you pay for 3 or 5 years. In a cloud model, you pay on a utilization basis. Now, for us, that means right now the minimum period you have a VM for is a month, yeah? Because we're working through maturing some of our financial processes. So you don't pay based on the minutes you consume, you pay for it in monthly units. And that means that developers aren't motivated to rip down the VMs, very quickly. And that's a behavioral change we're having to work through the organization. Now, as we mature our financial process, we'll get that down to something that looks very like a phone bill, right? You use this many minutes per month, here's your invoice, and we'll recover money much more frequently. The challenge that creates, though, is that banks don't typically have a mechanism for recovering the cost of unused capacity. Yeah, businesses pay for used capacity. Now, getting them to the point where they're happy to pay for unused capacity we're carrying in the cloud that fluctuates on a real-time basis, that's a completely different change, right? So the reason we're charging for monthly units right now is it's a small step. We know where we need to get to. It's just going to be a while. Okay, been told we're out of time. So I think you know where I live. So any questions, drop me an email, or vasil@riskfocus.com. More than happy to help you through whatever challenges you have or tell you some more about the problems that we solved and how we got to where we are. Okay, thank you.